Problem three. In a non-isosceles triangle ABC, the midpoints of AC and AB are B1 and C1 respectively. A point D lies on BC with C between B and D. The point F is such that angle AFC is a right angle and angle DCF is equal to angle FCA. The point G is such that angle AGB is a right angle and angle CBG is equal to angle GBA. Prove that B1, C1, F and G are collinear.
So here we have our triangle ABC drawn in red, and the line BC has been extended. We've added the extra segments mentioned in the problem statement, so you can see those two right angles and the points F and G. And we're supposed to show that the straight line through F and G passes through the points B1 and C1. And that sort of looks right. But when thinking about how to do this problem, I think it's clear that there isn't enough diagram. You need to add some stuff in order to make it more easy to work with. And there are various things you could do. I'll show you one that works quite quickly. So here's the idea. Produce, or some people say extend, AG until it hits the bottom line BC at G1. And do the same thing with the point F. Produce AF until it hits the bottom line BC at F1. Now look what you've got over at the left-hand side of the diagram here. It seems as if you have what look to be like two congruent triangles, each with a right angle in. Well, are they congruent? Well, yes, they are, by angle side angle, ASA. Because of the angle bisector here, those two angles match up. You've got the two right angles, and the side in between them is common. So they're definitely congruent. That means that the distance from A to G and from G to G1 are going to be the same. And so the distance AG1 is going to be twice the distance AG. Exactly the same story is going to happen over on the right-hand side of the diagram. You get two triangles, which look as if they are congruent, right-angled triangles, and for exactly similar reasons, they are congruent. And so the distance AF1 is twice the distance AF. Well, this is all very, very interesting, because it means that we have the option of bringing an enlargement argument into play. Let's have a go at that. So let's consider the enlargement from A with scale factor 1/2. Because what that will do is it will drag the point B to C1 and the point C to B1. And from what we've just done, it will drag F1 to F and G1 to G. In fact, it will carry the whole straight line BC to a straight line here, which passes through those four points. And therefore, they lie on a line. They are collinear. And we've finished the problem. It's all done, as if by magic. But there are other ways to look at this. I'll show you a sort of general approach to another way of doing it. So here's the diagram again, slightly changed. We've thrown away the side AC, and we've drawn in a new line in green. This is a line horizontal here. It's parallel to BC, and it passes through the point A. There's a magenta circle there. I want you to ignore that for the moment. Now, we have this angle bisector here that was specified in the question, the line BG. And, well, this line here, AG, also turns out to be an angle bisector. If you believe that, then, of course, what happens is that you have an angle bisector here and an angle bisector there, and they're meeting at a special point. Now, you may be familiar with drawing the incircle of a triangle. The incircle of a triangle is obtained by, well, to find its center, its incenter, you intersect at least two of the angle bisectors of the triangle. Well, in a sense, this huge diagram here is like it's like a kind of infinite degenerate triangle with two parallel sides. But the argument works just the same. If you wanted to construct a circle which was tangent to the top line and the bottom line and to AB, then what you would do would be to intersect the angle bisectors. And that's how we produce this circle in magenta. Now, why is this an angle bisector here, the line AG? Well, it's an angle chase. There's not much going on in this diagram. You know, the theorems about parallel lines and transversals and the angles of a triangle adding up to 180, that's all you need. I'll leave that to you. So, that assuming you've done that, then that circle is conjured into existence, and the point G is the center of that circle. And so, of course, it is halfway between the parallel lines, because the distance from that point G to each of the parallel lines is the same, because it's the radius of that circle. A very similar story will work with F. So we've just played the same game, but over on the right-hand side of the diagram. This time, we've thrown away the side AB, and look over here. You've got the angle bisector that is given in the specification of the problem, and another angle bisector, which you have to prove is an angle bisector, by a similar angle chase to the one you did just now. And that proves that the point F is just like the point G. It's halfway between the parallel lines. And I leave it to you to sort out why it is that B1 and C1 are on that same line. There are lots of ways to play with this problem and get some more results. We've got, in our version of the question, we had an angle bisector here and an angle bisector here given. But there are other angle bisectors. What about the angle bisector of that angle? And what about the angle bisector of that angle? Does everything work for them? Well, of course it does. And using the second method, there will be circles in play, which are tangent to various lines. Why don't you investigate that and sort it all out?